Buenos días, bienvenidos a...
Good morning and welcome to this new webinar organized by the Naturgy Foundation. On this occasion, we're going to present a new publication that does some research on the recycling of wind turbines, PV plants, and batteries towards the end of their life cycle. The foundation always tries to bring hot topics, interesting topics on energy and the environment and sustainability, and this is one of them. The generation of energy from clean energy, from clean sources, has boomed over the last few years. Given the goals of decarbonizing the economy we have in Europe, this is quite a challenge to achieve by 2030 and 2050. Like I said, these are tall orders and we cannot renounce to them. After this year's events and the invasion of Ukraine by Russia, it is ever more clear to be energy independent and develop clean energies to achieve independence as soon as possible. Well, against this backdrop, we see new challenges that we had not considered before. And let me summarize this in two. First, what are we going to do? What is the scenario we should consider? What can we do with all of these materials once these installations come to the end of their life cycle? And what about the need for raw materials and critical materials for the new renewable energies to be deployed over the next few years? There are two key data points in the report that I've been quite surprised, and they are a call of concern. The European Union depends on other countries to obtain the materials for renewable energies. We are importing close to 80% of the demand. And then by 2030, for every 9 million tons of materials for new PV plants, we will be generating 1 million tons of waste. You might think this is far removed, but it is right around the corner. What is the solution for these? Well, there are many solutions, but one is quite what's important, which is adding recycling to the mix. And that's why we think it is a good time to talk about this. How can we promote this? What are the measures we can undertake? How can recycling contribute to this boom in renewable energies? The technological development, regulation, the feasibility of companies in the field are very relevant matters right now, and definitely we will cover them today. So for the discussion, we have great experts in the field here. As you can see in the agenda, we're going to have Teresa Grijalmo presenting first. She's an asset manager at EIT InnoEnergy, and the report has been put together by them. EIT InnoEnergy leads in Europe in applying innovation to sustainable development. Then there's going to be a round table facilitated by Laura Ojea, a journalist specialized in energy and the environment at the newspaper El Español. And then the panelists are Mr. Marcos Morel, manager, director of renewable energies and electricity market at IDEA, and we have the innovation director at Naturgy, and Jacek Truszynski, deputy head of the Green and Circular Economy Unit from the European Commission, is connected online. And then Teresa will join the discussion as well after she presents her report. We believe this is going to be very interesting. And this report, just like the other reports of the foundation, is available for download freely on the website. We would like to thank you. There are over 400 people connected or here on site. And thank you very much for joining. Teresa, you have the floor.
Gracias.
Thank you so much. Can you all hear me? Good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for joining this webinar, either in person or remotely. I'm Teresa Grijalmo, and I work for EIT InnoEnergy. I'm one of the co-authors of the study. So today, I will be presenting this study on behalf of the other co-authors and other people who were involved in preparing this study. In the next 25 minutes, I will walk you through the highlights of this study. And then if you want more color on this study, I would like to invite you to download this study. This is a booming topic right now that it's quite in the spotlight, not only in Europe, but also in the rest of the world. So we are now showing the presentation on the screen. As you know, if you are involved in the energy sector right now, the European Union has put in place some very ambitious plans in order to deploy renewable energy in the forthcoming years, mainly because over the past decades, we have proved that we have competitive technologies, efficiency, and this is a sector that is creating jobs and that is making an economic contribution to Europe. On the other hand, we have storage. So we have also electric mobility. We have some ambitious forecasts, and we have storage that will enable us to keep a stable grid. In addition, we should bear in mind that there are many farms and many facilities that will come to the end of their life cycle. Therefore, we had to start thinking what we're going to do with all such materials from a sustainability standpoint and from the viewpoint of access to all such inputs, which are so critical. Afterwards, we will talk about such critical inputs. This is one of the pain points for Europe at this point in time. So to date, 80% of all the raw materials or inputs used by Europe are imported, China playing a key role worldwide. 60% of worldwide demand of materials is obtained from China. Therefore, this economic reliance triggers off an alarm, and we should pay attention to this, especially against the current background. For that reason, we believe that recycling will play a key role when all such renewable energy facilities come to an end of their life cycle. At the beginning of this year, Naturgy contacted EIT in Energy to start thinking about this study. Altogether, we came to the conclusion that we can no longer speak about recycling unless we talk about inputs. And this has been the starting point of the study, which I hope you will enjoy. Before I walk you through the study, let me talk quickly about EIT Inno Energy and the experts that Fundación Energy contacted. We belong to the European Innovation and Technology Institute. We believe that innovation is a driving engine that will allow for a green transition. We have been working for 10 years supporting new technologies. We have supported about 500 new technologies. We are present all over Europe, and we also have an office in Boston. And in Inno Energy, we have been trying to bridge the gap between the industry, between scientific centers, entrepreneurs. We have try to bridge such a gap in order to build a collaborative framework to make things happen. Furthermore, and in energy, we are certain that Europe has the right ideas, the capacities, and the value chain required in order to set up a sustainable energy industry. That's why, as you can see at the bottom of this slide, over the past years, we have been working hand in hand with other stakeholders regarding green hydrogen or solar energy. We want to bring this value chain to Europe in order to become energy independent, because that's our ultimate goal. So based on our experience, we have created an ecosystem, and Fundación Naturgy therefore believed that we had an interesting viewpoint that we could contribute to conducting this study. That has been our purpose. So let's get down to the study as such. Javier Sanz is the renewable energies thematic leader at INNO Energy, Luis Molina. He is responsible for raw materials for batteries and storage. And then myself, I'm the investment manager in the Iberian Peninsula. We try to seek innovative solutions in the area of sustainability. So let me give you an overview. I'm not going to give you too many details because I only have 25 minutes. In order to understand the overall structure of our study, I would like to say that at first we identified that we had to evaluate some estimates with regard to the deployment of renewable energies and the waste that will result from such facilities. Therefore, we had to identify any potential impact and the roadblocks we might encounter in order to set up recycling facilities, taking into account all stakeholders. We closed off the study, providing a forward-looking view, analyzing some of the current solutions underway, and what business model we could put in place in order to allow for a sustainable future recycling system. As I said before, recycling is no longer important just from a sustainability perspective, but also from a critical raw material standpoint. In Europe right now, this is absolutely relevant. Out of 30 raw materials that are considered to be critical, 10 of them are obtained from China. China is right now the leading producer of all such materials in the world. 60% of lithium is processed in China, which shows that we are highly dependent on China. We need to sort that out. So how are we going to extract such raw materials locally here in Europe? That's the question. Mining is not a very significant sector in Europe. That is therefore a handicap because that's the very source of all such raw materials, or most of them. In Europe, there is an European raw materials initiative in progress. We have identified that we have to take action right away. And according to this raw materials initiative, we are told which key factors should be considered in order to consider a particular raw material to be critical. For example, geographical accessibility, the economic value of such raw materials, or even the economic value of recovering such materials, also the availability of natural resources, what happens after recycling, what kind of purity levels can we achieve to see whether we can reintroduce these inputs into different sectors, and any imbalances between supply and demand. For this purpose, we need to understand both deployment and waste production forecasts. Now, let's deep dive into the study and let's talk about some of the projections we have analyzed. This is clearly described in the document. If we talk about PV, we can see that the PV industry is already a booming sector. This is not news. This is a technology that has been evolving over the past decades and is really providing us with a solution to energy access, and this is critical. In 2021, since 2011, we see that installed capacity reached 34 year on year. Taking into account that we were coming from the pandemic when we had many issues with access to supply and logistics products. So the European Union said, okay, now we have to set ourselves even more ambitious goals. So in the RePower EU plan laid down by the European Commission, we read that up to 40 gigawatt per year should be installed in Europe. So as you can see, this is an ambitious goal that we should achieve according to this plan. Now, in the long term, RePower EU also foresees that by 2030, installed capacity will be 335 gigawatts and 30 gigawatts in 2022. So as you can see, this is already here around the corner, and we see that these plans are already taking shape. Now, this means that PV panels at the end of the day are made up of common materials that are non-hazardous. Fortunately, we are talking about mainly about the weight of these panels, but then these panels also contain other hazardous products, which may be toxic or perhaps because they are scarce. In this study, we have considered silicon and silver. Silver in the world is mainly used in the photovoltaic sector in the world. So this is something to be taken into account. What's going to happen with all these materials? This is quite a straightforward graph, but you can see a curve that is growing exponentially. And we should get ready for this situation. Waste will grow exponentially. And the more we use the more these materials, the more we will have to recover them. According to estimates, the estimated amount of obsolete modules by 2030 will reach 1 million tons. In Europe, Spain plays a key role because we are leaders in generating this waste. According to this study, by 2050 in Spain, between 1 to 2 million tons of waste will be generated. This slide shows there will be supplies between now and the short term. However, there will be some specific materials that will show some scarcity. This means that we will have to recover them in order to bring them back into the photovoltaic industry. According to projections, by 2050, Europe will only generate 1 million tons of waste less than its installed capacity. So we have to focus on those materials that are under tension in order to decide how we are going to replace such materials. We could replace them, or else when designing panels, we could use such materials to lower extent. Right now, we had to think from a circularity perspective to make sure that such materials are not wasted. In the case of wind power, we have sort of a different picture. This is also a booming sector. We believe that wind power will be deployed massively, not only onshore, but also offshore. However, in the case of wind power, the culture in place is a little bit different, where circularity is more present. Because here we see that wind turbines usually utilize recycled components. As a result, in this study, we had to analyze not only future deployments, but also all those wind farms that will be dismantled in order to consider those components that can be recycled. However, the wind power industry, although it's a booming sector, it is foreseen that all the materials that are used for WTGs will also increase. 30 new gigawatts will be installed, whereas 10 gigawatts a year will be withdrawn. Therefore, we have to consider both installation and withdrawal of such gigawatts, because in the case of wind turbines, we see materials that are more generic or that are easier to recycle, like in the case of PV panels. But these WTGs contain critical materials such as rare earth elements and some compound matter that are present in the components used in turbines. And they might be scarce in the future. Therefore, we believe that we will need to recover such materials. On the other hand, regarding storage, We have focused on lithium batteries that are used in the automotive sector specifically, because these batteries will account for 80% of this sector. Therefore, we believe that it's worth assessing this sector. China also plays a leading role regarding manufacturing and deployment. In Europe, we have a very significant market share. Therefore, this is something that we have to start addressing immediately. It is foreseen that in the forthcoming years, this deployment will be even greater. By 2030, in the automotive sector, it is foreseen that electric vehicles will account for 50% of sales. Therefore, how are we going to make this sustainable? What does deploying electric vehicles really mean? Well, it means that within a few years, especially as of 2026 and 2027, we will play witness to the waste produced by this sector, and we will need to have a solution in place in order to tackle that issue. As for critical materials used in batteries, we observe that by 2035, which is right around the corner, we will have to recover 30% of the cobalt used in batteries already withdrawn, and up to 20% of lithium. Therefore, in the case of batteries, we are speaking about sort of a new market. In the case of PV and wind power, these technologies have been in place for a longer period of time. Right now, batteries are being pushed forward, but we will see how this falls out in the forthcoming years. So we no longer speak about critical materials or deployment only. We had to start thinking about how we will eventually face this issue. So we need to understand what we are doing at present in order to answer that question. In the case of the photovoltaic sector, and we're coming back to this first pillar, we already find new ways of recycling. This slide shows how the different components are sorted out. Right now, the most common process to recycle PV panels is a mechanical process. So we break up the different components, and we have no access to the critical materials that are used to manufacture such components. In the future, we intend to recover such critical materials using processes or technologies that can be chemical, thermal, and not only mechanical processes in order to recover this silicon or silver that we want to bring back into the PV sector or that we want to reutilize in other sectors. The goal is not to lose such materials in the long run. What happens with wind power? Once again, wind power goes through a similar process. There are many initiatives in progress in order to recover or reuse components. In the case of wind power, 65% of components will be recycled or reused, whereas the remaining 35% is part of waste. Therefore, as part of this 35%, we're talking about compound materials mainly that are not so toxic, are more inert, but they also require further investigation because they can be visually very impactful, and we want to avoid that. And then we have rare earth elements. These are very valuable materials that abate over the long run, and they therefore require specific processes of recycling. Now, REEs usually appear in low concentrations in some components used in WTGs. Therefore, in order to recover these REEs, we should not incur too many costs for the sector to really be willing to pay for it. In Europe, here you can see the list of manufacturers. It's not a very long list. We have a market niche where manufacturers may be keen on manufacturing wind turbines in such a way that they can recover these components from the very beginning. That way they will be more actively involved and a more standardized system will be put in place. Okay, let us now talk about batteries. This is perhaps the youngest of all the three sectors we have just described and the one that is expected to boom as well. We do not yet have a huge mass of waste coming from this market niche, but it will happen in the future. However, we are talking about a complex scenario because in this case, we do not have standards as we have applicable to wind power and there is no economy of scale. So in the future, we would like to bring all manufacturers on board, whether those that produce batteries or automotive parts, so that they get involved in reducing critical materials from the very onset. And in order to facilitate permitting so that this recycling of batteries can become a reality in the short term. There are several initiatives regarding recycling. There are some companies such as B-Planet. This is a Spanish company that already provides a solution to lengthen the life of batteries. So we are talking not only about having technologies ready for recycling, we are talking about having a scheme and a system in place that can favor the reinforcement of this market in Europe. We should take regulations into account. The study contains information about regulations enforced both in Spain and in Europe, but I'm not going to speak specifically about this right now, because afterwards we will discuss this topic during the debate, so I'm sure that they have many interesting insights to share. However, let me give you an overview. In Europe, there are already some directives and some regulations that make recycling compulsory. Such regulations are enforced by each member state and are part of their national laws. As a result, we know which processes can now be managed by each country. We say that batteries is perhaps the youngest market right now, but they have learned about prior experience and they have regulations to govern recycling processes whereby they have to provide for a circular approach to storage. And in closing, we have spoken about technology, we have spoken about regulations, about targets. How will this market be installed in Europe? Well, we believe that we need to have a business model supporting it. Therefore, we need to talk about financing. This must be a viable sector. It must be economically feasible. If it does not generate profits, at least it should make sure that we can recover materials in order to cut down on costs. So in this study, we submit a generic business model that we believe could be a reasonable one in order to set up these structures in each European country. So the purpose of this business model is to minimize waste. So as far as possible, we should reutilize this waste, bringing them back into each sector. And then we should also consider how we are going to manage what we cannot recycle, how we can do that in a sustainable manner. So we need to build a system that can make pickup processes viable And then we will have to assess all the recovered materials. We will have to assess their value, if they are valuable materials, and if, for example, it can be recovered by a particular business sector, things will be easier because these incentives will already be part of the market. Producers will be more actively involved, and we will have a stable system in place in order to control the whole process from manufacturing to the recovery of these materials and reutilization, either in the same sector or in a different industry. Sometimes the technological processes that are used for recycling purposes do not reach the same purity levels required by the market, but perhaps we could use them in other sectors that are not so demanding in that regard. Now, what happens if the critical materials concerned are not so available? In that case, we will have some financing requirements from a very early stage. We will have to use a sort of eco-levy or tax that will be levied on the final price charged to users. We will need to have some models to deal with scraps. This is something that some European countries are already doing, and this will be promoted through regulations or different economic initiatives that will make this possible. So this is the conclusion of our study. So I just wanted to give you an overview, but if you want further details about the study, again, I encourage you to download the document. So we have spoken about the key role played by recycling, not only from a sustainability perspective, but also in order to recover critical materials that are so important in order to achieve energy independence in Europe. We said that we need to have the right framework in place to mitigate risks, which means that we need to have the right laws in force and the right economic systems to allow for these business models to take place. In this study, we also speak about the stakeholders, about the technologies and initiatives that should be considered to make this business sustainable and in order to make it possible. And finally, we come from a very bad experience as a result of shortage of oil and gas. So if we envisage that this is going to be a critical point in the future, we have to start taking action right now. And I believe that a study like this can really, well, promote such initiatives in order to report on more successful stories in the future and in order to recover these critical materials more successfully as well. And I thus come to an end of my presentation. So now let me turn to Laura, who will moderate the debate. I hope that you have enjoyed the study. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Teresa. Yes, we're going to talk about this very interesting report you just presented. And we're going to have some outstanding speakers around the table. I have briefly introduced Maria Eugenia, but I would like to mention more about her professional background. She's been involved in the development of corporate programs to accelerate innovation around energy. And she's also monitored tech growth projects in renewable energies. And to her side, we have Victor Marcos Morel, industrial engineer by the Polytechnic University of Madrid and a state engineer since 2016. So more than 10 years of experience in the energy industry, particularly renewable energies. You've performed different jobs around renewables, risks analysts for one. And you've also participated in project promotion and sales, and you've also been part of projects in the Energy and Climate Integrated National Plan, together with Foresight Energy Analysis and Regulation Development. Thank you very much for joining us. And then Francisca Cao, a mining engineer of the Polytechnic University of Madrid, MBA by ESIC, over 20 years of experience in industrial environments, nationally and internationally. She works in innovation at Naturgy. She's been holding that role for 8 years, and she's in charge of procurement. Well, she's been in charge of procurement in the past, and now she's in the innovation team. And then on the screen, direct from Brussels, we have Jacek Truszynski, connected deputy head of the Green and Circular Economy Unit, the Market and Industry DG. For the European Commission. He's worked in the DG of Economic and Financial Affairs prior to that, and Regulatory Affairs linked to energy efficiency and renewable energies. Thank you very much for joining us, Mr. Truszynski, for the presentation of this report. I believe it is now time to start our panel. Mr. Truszynski, if it's okay with you, maybe you can start sharing on the European Commission's position on this matter, which is already affecting us, but definitely will affect us even more. I'm talking about these raw materials and what to do with waste in renewable energies. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your invitation to the seminar. I apologize that I don't speak Spanish. It would be better, of course, to exchange in your native language, but unfortunately, I do not speak Spanish. But the topic is extremely hot. I can say, you know, the message from Brussels would be that this is indeed something that is top on the agenda of policymakers here, of the president, of the commission, of the heads of state and government. These topics are discussed typically in their meetings today. And these topics, by these topics, I mean, on the one hand, the green transition, and on the other hand, the strategic autonomy. And this broad, let's say, background was already well presented by the Director General of the Naturgy Foundation in her introduction. I would just add a couple of elements to that. So, you know, there was a reference already to the invasion of Ukraine by Russia that, you know, clearly what this in this horrible story, one positive element is that it really accelerated already our transition towards a green energy system. You can see it on the ground. The rate of deployment of solar has notably really accelerated, for wind less so, but we are trying to address it notably by issuing regulations that provide for much faster permitting for those wind projects than was in the past. So we can expect, as was also presented in the presentation on the report, an acceleration of the deployment of those technologies. So that's good. At the same time, absolutely top on the agenda is that we do not want to find ourselves in 5 years in the same place as we are today vis-a-vis Russian gas, but in the future vis-a-vis critical raw materials and components imported notably from China. And here, you know, we see it for solar, over 90% dependence on China. For batteries, we have notably, thanks to our cooperation with EIT Ina Energy, developed a very strong sector in the EU over recent years, but still, when you look at some of the key inputs, the critical raw materials, we still depend, of course, on China. So how to address it is absolutely top of the agenda. And what do we do about it? So we notably, referring to those three technologies, for batteries, we have the Battery Alliance. And of course, part of that industrial deployment project is also how to create business models to improve recyclability. We also are finalizing with member states and the European Parliament negotiations on a battery regulation, which will notably provide for recyclability, very far-reaching provisions. We can go into that later on in the debate. For solar, we will also have a new solar PV alliance based on the success model of the Battery Alliance that will be launched in Brussels on the 9th of December. We want to reshore that sector, the whole value chain, from polysilicon to modules, all the way through wafers, ingots, and so on. And of course, part of that picture is how to stimulate models for greater recyclability. We also will table soon rules, so-called eco-design rules, for solar modules placed on the EU market, which will notably include requirements related to recycled content and durability. And for wind, I think that was also visible in the presentation of the report that wind is slightly different because of the different, let's say, business model of its deployment, more business to business than business to consumer, but also in terms of the types of materials that are used in wind installations. But still, we are also talking to the EU wind sector, where notably Spain is also still a very strong actor, how to drive recyclability and also how to improve the competitiveness of the EU industry through certain recyclability requirements. Because if we talk about, for example, auctions for clean power for wind installations, could we, for example, think of basing those auctions in the future not only on prices, but also on certain qualitative elements that the industry can provide in terms of recycling, in terms of recycled content and so on, something that can be good for the environment, but also can be good for the EU industry vis-a-vis Chinese partners. So that would be by way of introduction, maybe last reference to a proposal that we are currently developing, the so-called Critical Raw Materials Act should be tabled early next year, and it will be a horizontal legislation that will try to create a whole ecosystem in the EU that will improve our access to critical raw materials, notably those used in those green technologies. So mining, extraction, but also refining, and of course, recycling and recovery. Thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to the debate.
Muchas gracias, señor Jacek.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tuschinski. Well, all the plans and developments in the European Union look very promising. I would like to know now what is the position nationally at IDEA of regarding all of these points. Well, I would like to thank the Naturgy Foundation. I believe this is a very important conversation, and I would like to thank you for the report. It is absolutely essential to create knowledge and know where we are in order to make decisions about the future. We manage aid for renewable. This is at the frontier between renewable energy and shared economy. We've worked together with other ministerial bodies to manage part of the national plan for shared economy. So what do we have in Spain? Teresa mentioned and Jacek mentioned it too. What do we have? Well, there is a need to develop renewable energies this decade. There is a challenge to some of the assets in the wind turbines, for example, are coming to the end of their life cycle, but PV will follow soon. And the invasion of Russia, of Ukraine by Russia, has created a sense of urgency. We need to improve our energy security. It is strategic. It goes beyond the environmental rationale. So as a continent, as a country, as the European Union, we realize that now that we cannot rely on foreign countries extensively for these materials. And as we make progress with the green transition, operational costs are smaller, but there are investment costs for renewable energies, and the costs are relevant. So the consumption, the material during this first stage is greater than the consumption we will see later. In any case, we know for a fact now that we're going to need these and we cannot be dependent. So we have the shared economy strategy for 2030. It sets the grounds to achieve the goals we have in mind. We've created the roadmap for sustainable management for mining materials at the ministry recently. As Teresa said, we cannot talk about recycling only. We need to talk about raw materials. It's an encompassing discussion. We need to strike a balance in our roadmap. As Teresa mentioned, China is one of the main producers of many critical materials. And so we need to work on this. We want this industrial development, and this means that this is a long-term policy. We cannot say overnight, well, this is what we wanted to do, and we do it. No, we need to work on it as part of a strategy. There are a couple of documents that implement the goals and the strategies. I'm talking about the two national plans, PERTES, for the one about the shared economy I already mentioned, and the one on renewable energies. We're going to manage part of the shared economy national recovery plan led by quality and evaluation. And there's another PERTE where we have the repower line for wind energy. It has been recently approved. It's been published in the National Gazette, and over the next few weeks, it will be, well, fully approved with all levels of details, and we can cover more details about this later. Sure, we can talk about the coming regulation. And now, Naturgy, Francisca, what about this new business concept?
Well, as a matter of fact, at Naturgy, we are the very promoters of several photovoltaic facilities for renewable energies in many locations. And we are committed, we are also responsible for shutting down and dismantling those facilities that come to the end of their life. Spain today has a high level of potential in this regard because many wind farms that were built in the late 90s now require some repowering or, in some cases, recycling or even shutting down. So we are a little bit worried. We remember, for example, wind turbine blades being digged into landfills. We believe that now a step forward has been made requesting the European Commission not to dump such waste into landfills. So we believe that many opportunities are opening up and we have to face this challenge, not only because this can give rise to a new industry, but also, as we mentioned before, because we need to be independent in producing critical inputs, which are so important to manufacture new products and also to create new businesses within Europe so that we can be competitive in the United States, where 40% of tariffs are already being applied on Chinese imports. So this is quite an opportunity. We're also vulnerable in the face of economies such as that of China, and the pandemic proved such vulnerability. In times of lack of supply or shortage of supply, we become particularly sensitive to high prices and we run the risk of having scarcity or delays in the supply chain. I'm sure that at EIT in Energy, you take the pulse of the sector and you know what the sector expects about recycling of materials. Well, I like that metaphor, Laura. So it's going to be difficult to draw some conclusions, but it's true that since we are involved in innovation, we are constantly taking a look at the market to identify their needs and spot opportunities. The entrepreneurial world is larger and larger. There are very good ideas out there, and we see that many ideas are now intended to make circularity possible. There are several European initiatives already in the pipeline that focus on the value chain and the manufacturing processes. So we are trying to promote those initiatives that may solve all these issues. We are encouraging people to show those technologies to us so that we can help them reduce their costs and reach the market. We are firm believers in innovation, and we are convinced that this is the cornerstone in order to make a change towards the energy transition. So you see that the market is being sensitive to these issues. So you have mentioned that there are some initiatives already in the pipeline. Are there any highlights?
Well, Jacek mentioned earlier the European Alliance for Batteries. It didn't need to get critical in Ukraine to launch this. From the very beginning, it's been identified this is a new industry. We've got access to a lot of research forecasts and knowledge and expertise that tells us this is going to be a problem going forward. So with this type of alliance, we are trying to bring the manufacturer of batteries towards Europe, and we're trying to drive forth the mining and access to these materials. The European Solar Initiative is an initiative that was launched prior to this whole geopolitical situation, because we identified, we know what are the inputs of these materials, and there's a lot of science into eco designs, reducing critical materials in the manufacture of PV panels. And we increasingly see more solutions to set up the business model we talked about, to make it a reality, so that we don't send the waste to other countries. It is our waste, and we identify the value. So there are now technologies to recover these materials specifically that we were talking about. So there are industry-wide initiatives that are going to develop the recycling of renewable energy materials coming from old plants.
So I see that we already see a lot of movement in Europe. So Mr. Jacinski, how is this being promoted in Europe so that all these initiatives that have these European components can finally attain their set targets?
Thank you. Well, from the European Commission perspective, the perspective of a regulator, I think our role is to regulate and also channel financing where it is needed. So, I think these are the means through which we can achieve the targets. And the targets themselves, I think we also have to set them first to be able then to establish tools to achieve those targets. And so if you look at batteries, so the battery regulation, I think this is a really landmark legislation, because it goes much further than what we had for product legislation in the past. So in the past, under eco-design, when we were regulating, say, washing machines or TV screens or heat pumps, we could set requirements at the product level. So when the product was placed on the EU market, we could say that X percent of its content should come from recovery and recycling. Now, with the battery regulation, we go further. So just to say a couple of things there, we will have, of course, requirements on the recycled content of those batteries. So for things like cobalt or lead, there will be specific targets for 2030 and 2035 for recycled content at the product level. There will be also requirements at the product level for things like performance and durability, which will, of course, improve the waste management of those products. But more than that, we will also have, let's say, process-related requirements. So there will be requirements for, notably, on the collection of waste. There will be specific waste targets for 2025 and 2030. And I cannot say what will be the level of ambition of those targets because they are still being negotiated. But those negotiations should be concluded soon. And last element, there will be also an obligation to recover a specific percentage of lithium used in those batteries. So the first aspect, how to, you know, to respond to your question, how we can achieve our objectives is through regulation. And the second, I would say, is financing. And it was interesting to hear the colleague from EIT presenting results of the study, because it shows that you have to differentiate between those different technologies. For the recovery of certain more valuable components, you may not need to have subsidy schemes because the market itself will address it. But for other elements, you need things like the green taxes that were referred to here. So I think the report is a good starting point to identify those elements where specific financing would be necessary. Thank you.
And thank you, Mr. Caso in España.
Now, coming back to Spain, are there any specific plans that we can start talking about? Yes, I have already mentioned the so-called PERTE or PERTE. This is a plan that has already helped us, and I believe that the funds coming from Europe will certainly endorse further plans in order to help us in our energy transition and in order to implement many technologies and realize many other opportunities and projects. We see many interesting projects in the pipeline, for example, in the case of sustainable mobility. We observe a number of cutting-edge projects. We have already heard about some companies, some award-winning companies that received subsidies in order to promote technologies. This has to do with, therefore, electric mobility and other sectors that will require due battery management. So design and recycling are important. It's very important to decide whether we will be able to reutilize assets. In the case of batteries, we could use those batteries in electric vehicles, and we have to make sure that they meet the necessary technicalities in order, for example, to be used in households. Now, what else do we find in these national recovery plans or PERTEs? Well, this is also concerned with the circular economy. In this case, there is a significant component in order to retrofit wind farms and recycling materials. There are some wind turbine components that can be easily recycled, such as steel, but there are other components that are perhaps more difficult to recycle, such as the electronic components, and then the blades. 80% of blades are made up of compound products. This is mentioned in the circular economy National Recovery Plan. We will have to retrofit many wind farms, and right now there is no technological solution available. I believe that we will talk about that later. There's no technology, no single technology that actually enables us to do this by using renewable energies. To separate compound materials from fiber, you need to go through a thermal process requiring high temperatures, and that's very difficult to do unless you use fossil energy. So we need to consider a number of elements to classify projects to see which projects require more subsidies. 30% had to do with innovation capabilities and the remainder with other aspects. So we will grant subsidies based on those considerations, and always taking innovation into account. Now, let me speak specifically about circular economy. We have line one that is focused on the textile, plastic, and renewable equipment sectors. And then we have line two that is a cross-cutting line that has to do with the circular economy. Okay, so we will come back to that in a minute, but let me ask you, how do you think this industry will be profitable or sustainable to reach our goals? From a business perspective, or at least from Naturgy's perspective, do you think that we are fully aware of this problem? Are we conscious about the future or about the decomposition of these components?
Of course, we pay attention to it and we're working on it. We are firmly committed to innovate in this regard, not just because it is a need or because it is a must, but because it is strategic. These raw materials are scarce. And also we've seen and verified across various technologies that profitable businesses can be created. So it is a niche to be explored for as a corporation for us. Now, PV plants, that's the most urgent ones because the number of plants coming to the end of their life cycle prone for recycling are coming up. It is a reality and a lot of progress has been made. I was reading the literature and I was reading that 90%, we can reuse 90% of the basic elements. Now, it is true, as Teresa mentioned, we need to focus on that remaining 10% because those are the elements that can create more value, rare earths and compound materials. Now, if we go upstream in the value chain of wind turbines, the manufacturers of the technology are researching and are very keen on developing 100% recyclable blades, for example. So they are working on that eco-design. Siemens Gamesa, General Electric are piloting their first prototypes. Now, PV is slightly behind because the big plants still have a long life cycle ahead, but self-consumption and what's coming is helping us reassess the value chain. We have 80% recovery rates for the main elements, the biggest and the heaviest, but then there is a 20% that requires our focus. 2 weeks ago, we were part of a talk where it was mentioned that in order to reach our goals for 2050, we need the amount of silver that corresponds to the resources found in three earths. So recycling, we don't have that clearly. Recycling is a need. Regarding the recycling of materials, we depend on what the car industry is doing because they lead in storage and they have a wealth of experience that we can learn from. There is another challenge in terms of innovation and technology to take care of. The market is heavily atomized. There are many designs and there are different elements and therefore we need more volume to start standardizing processes. Now, that shows there is another opportunity to start generating value through knowledge, corporations, and so on. There's an important comment I would like to make. Innovation requires large budgets and therefore large corporations. But we see a shift. We have small startups with a wealth of expertise and knowledge that are contributing now with great plans, and they might be the big companies in the recycling business going forward. Well, I see that there is a silver lining here. Now, Mr. Tuschinski, I would like to ask you, do we have the right pace? Are we going to make it in time? This regulation that will boost this new line of business will help us meet these goals. Are we progressing at the right speed?
Thank you for the question. I think if we talk about, because the question about speed mainly today is about deployment, I think. And there clearly, when you look at the amount of wind installations that we have in Europe, it's probably 30% of what we should do per year to achieve our Repower EU objective. So I think what we need to do is really accelerate deployment above all. But that will mean, as discussed already by the panel participants, that also the pace of waste generated by those installations as they come to the end of life will accelerate. But I think I can be reassuring, because as was also mentioned by the panel participants, we are only now reaching a stage where those installations are starting to have their end of life moment for solar PV and for windmills, and for batteries we are still some years before we reach this in bulk levels, let's say. And if you look at the requirements that we will set through those regulations applying to batteries or to solar PVs, they will come in time to address those waste streams, because they will start applying already as of 2025. So I think what we need to do above all is to accelerate deployment, and indeed with those rules that we are setting up, be then in time to capture the waste that will be generated by those additional installations. But there, as I said, I think we will be able to do it. But of course, one thing is to set regulations, which is often easy. What is difficult is then to enforce it and to ensure that member states also allocate enough resources to do, for example, things like checking market compliance and so on. So this will be one of the challenges, I think, ahead.
Bueno, pues eso.
Okay, so we hope it will be so, Mr. Tuschinski. In the case of Spain, I understand that all such national recovery plans you have described refer to the different technologies, and I believe that wind power, PV power, etc., can resort to these sources. So if I'm a PV developer, which sources of regulations can I consult in order to develop these projects? Okay, let me draw a distinction. When talking about regulations, usually we mean the terms and conditions that are to be complied with. When talking about national recovery plans, however, we're talking about support plans that we try to use in order to support the implementation or deployment of a given technology. It's true that we try to go beyond current regulations. Talking about the repowering line, the requirement could be, for example, to achieve a 50% recyclability, but we don't want to stop there. We just want to go beyond just complying with the regulations. So from the regulatory viewpoint, we have to consider deployment and facilities. If we really want to meet our 2030-2050 targets, we need to install many renewable energy facilities onshore. We have to build many farms for that purpose. And then raises an evident regulatory challenge. Not only a regulatory challenge, but also one in terms of capacity. The latest initiatives that have been promoted by the EC, including the so-called emergency plan, that includes a number of permits in order to expedite as far as possible the award of authorizations. But going back to the national recovery plans, this is sort of the soft component. These PERTEs seek innovation, also achieving circular economy. As we mentioned before, there are, on the one hand, the so-called blades, that there are components that are easier to recycle. Then we have PV panels and we have batteries. Right now, we are going to start opening some windows. These subsidies can be granted or not based on a number of scores that we use in order to assess the different projects. And the projects are arranged based on quality and based on the scores that are used to rate them, using all necessary guarantees. Once the procedure is completed, well, some projects might be awarded these subsidies, others may not. But these will be therefore the subsidies that we will be providing for PV technologies or facilities or other technologies. The National Recovery Plan is just one channel. There are other channels, for example, another one for hydrogen. There are four all in all. Then there is the biogas channel. Then we have cross-cutting channels, one for self-service or self-consumption that uses a wealth of funds. Then we have the so-called energy communities. That's also another cross-cutting component to the PERTE. So little by little, we are implementing a number of initiatives that are all under the umbrella of the National Recovery Plan. These PERTEs are intending to give a strategic thrust to specific areas, particularly in the area of the circular economy and specifically with regard to renewable energies. For those of us who are following us remotely, please let me remind you that you can also post questions for our panelists and experts. While we wait for those questions to be posted, let us now talk about these regulations or subsidies that are being granted by public authorities, both in Spain and in Europe. How can they be transferred over to the private sector? You have one project in Naturgy called Gira Wind. Could you please describe that project?
Con la sostenibilidad y la economía circular.
We are committed to sustainability and the shared economy. And because of that, we've launched the Gira Wind initiative this year. It is a joint venture with Aurelia and other strategic partners. And it is going to manage fully the dismantling and recycling of wind farms. So given the potential we've got in Spain, let's not forget this is a country with great wind potential. Together with Denmark, France, Italy, and Germany, we've pioneered the field of wind farms. In fact, the Association of Wind Farm turbines, they were talking about 2 gigawatts of wind by 2025 will be older than 25 years, and 2.2 gigawatts will be older than 25 years. That is some 3,000 wind turbines that need to be recycled or repurposed. So this is huge potential. It's part of our strategy. We're striving to work with partners and suppliers of ours who've got experience in recycling material, for example, in their manufacturer. And then USO 29 is another one of our suppliers for the maintenance of wind farms. So with our experience, we want to shorten the learning curve and be more competitive. Now, with this project, we want to get traction with projects or replicate them across other countries so that we can move forward towards this fair transition. Regarding the dual role of promoting companies at EIT in no energy, do you see an interest there? Are there big differences across the technologies now? Wind is being promoted more than solar right now. Do you see these differences across technologies? Well, yes, there are differences. We're talking about markets that progress at different paces. And then depending on the country, priorities might vary within Europe. At EIT Inno Energy, we encompass renewables, mobility, all industries. We need to work on all. And we do see that there are new developments across all of them. If you look at the national recovery plans, well, we see it as a huge opportunity. We have a portfolio of startups where we hold stakes. These startups are around Europe, and these purchase national pranks give us an opportunity to bring some of these startups to Spain and have impact on Spain. Our goal is always to create in Europe. We have Rosy Solar, for example, a French startup that is recovering these critical materials from PV plants. They have a manufacturing plant in France, and they are expected to build abroad soon. And we work with there are other companies in our portfolio that recycle batteries. I mentioned B Planet earlier. It is a Spanish company. They are reusing these batteries. MecaWorks is another company in our portfolio that tries to recycle these more toxic, more critical components. And then in wind energy, there is a very important initiative, Renascycle, and the 18 business partners have joined in this initiative, and they want to encourage this shared economy in renewables. They are starting with wind, but eventually they want to cover all renewable sources of energy, because one supports another and vice versa, and we are one team in that regard. We are running out of time, but before we shut down, I would like to ask another question to Mr. Trzcinski. As we're talking about all of these initiatives in Spain, I would like to know, do you believe there is one single country that has made more progress than others with this type of progress, or are there many differences and there's a lot of diversity in Spain, in Europe, and there might be a competitiveness issue?
Thank you for the question. I think it's more valuable to look at individual companies than countries. So the answer we heard with the examples just before me by the author of the report was extremely, I think, useful. And looking at those champions like Rossi Solar, for example, we jointly have to, I think with the authorities of different member states, how we can replicate those examples. I suspect that some countries are more advanced than others. You know, typically that would be the countries that have industry champions and they were the pioneers in renewables installations in Europe. And of course, here we have Spain, we have Denmark, we have Germany, and clearly there is scope there to share best practice. Regarding your second part of the question, the competitiveness versus environmental friendliness, let's say, of those processes. I believe that there's no trade-off. I think actually that there are synergies between the two. I think I mentioned the example of auctions for clean power, which are only based on prices. If you compete only on prices, that creates very perverse effects, I think. And if you look at the market situation in the EU, wind companies, the original equipment manufacturers, are all in big troubles financially for many reasons. But part of the reason is that they have to compete on price only, and they have difficulties to compete with Chinese manufacturers on price only. So if you factor in the economic equation, the environmental added value that those companies bring, either through the way you design auctions or through those product requirements, such as eco-design, I think that helps the competitiveness of the EU industries. So, as I said, I think there are synergies, and we have to make sure that through the different tools we have, we make it happen. Thank you.
So we are running out of time, but we have plenty of questions from the audience. So now I'm going to read them aloud. So this question is for Victor from IDEA. So Spain has an issue with regards to permitting due to the need of classifying projects in order to decide whether those projects are viable or not. Could we include Well, could we classify these projects not only based on time? Well, I don't quite understand the question, but I believe that you have sort of grasped the overall meaning. Well, we have regulatory tools available. We know that we have many projects that have been submitted. There's kind of a backlog of projects that need to be analyzed. We get many applications. There are many regulatory tools that somehow bring some projects to maturity when they do not meet certain regulatory terms and conditions. And we have to wait sometimes to see what the public authorities decide in order to reactivate some of these milestones. There are other awards or other tenders that will be launched, and we will take into account different aspects. I don't know whether recycling will be considered in order to award projects, but I believe that we must be aware of the fact that this is a compelling issue. Recycling is compelling because unless we recycle, we will have a problem. That will be a fact. We will repower many megawatts, first with wind power and then with photovoltaic power and also with batteries. And we will have to deal with all that. But then we have another problem, a similar problem, and that is that we have to really make steady progress towards renewables. We have to be able to produce 100% of renewable energies. In the case of the electricity market, we are using only 45% of renewables. We should reach 60 gigawatts, and that is a lot of power. We will have to install a lot of power and very quickly. And we will have to do it right now. So prioritizing recycling over speed, I know that that places us at a crossroads, but we have to really continue moving fast because every year counts. And in closing, and if you could please answer more briefly, in the case of Ina Energy, do you think the new alternative materials are being searched for?
Yes, alternatives are sought after. New materials has always been very appealing and a great unknown because we see the opportunities they bring to many industries. So for the sake of time, yes, there are many initiatives in this regard. One more question for any and every one of you. Can financially self-sustainable models be created? Francesca. Yes, I believe so. Some processes need to be implemented to make it profitable at a macro level, but it's just a matter of volume and learning curve, yes. What about you? Do you think that opportunity exists? Yes, I do believe it exists and it is necessary. And then another question, is recycling a tool for the areas most affected by the fair transition? Victor, for example? Definitely. I mentioned it earlier. It is a challenge, but it's also an opportunity. There are many materials that we can leverage. Recycling is at some 37% in Spain. We need to increase that, up that figure. There is an industrial opportunity in renewable energies, without a doubt, and this is mentioned in the shared economy strategy. Jobs are going to be created. Actually, jobs were created in recycling by 12% from 2012 to 16, and it will eventually account for 5% of jobs in the European Union. There is an opportunity and we need to leverage. What do we want to do? Well, we want to make it happen. We want business cases to be feasible and the CAPEX is helpful. If the project is not technically feasible from an economic standpoint, well, there is nothing we can do. It's not that I think it can be done, it must be done. I understand Naturgy is working hard on that fair energy transition. And I understand that you see opportunities there, right? Yes, in fact, I mentioned this earlier. PV plants and wind farms are not in downtown. They are in rural areas, and these new business models should be developed in areas where logistics are easier, and that's where we want to work on this fair transition and create an industry in this low population areas. Okay, we've come to the end of this fantastic debate. I would like to highlight 4 points that I've learned with this report and with these comments from Brussels and Madrid. Creating a new industry and a necessary industry is one of the key points. We must do so, and this effort comes from public and private initiatives, from innovation, from large corporations, from startups, and from institutions and organizations such as Inno Energy. And I know that you're always working intensely on this, and that intention to, or to give us an outing from those geopolitical problems. This is a globalized world. We always need to take into account. In any case, thank you very much, everyone. It's been really interesting. See you on our next talk.